Would you believe and agree that girls do much better in academics in high school, but boys go ahead of them in college? Well, this is a very debatable topic and we are not going into it. For us, every individual is unique and such predictions meaningless. Hello, my name is Sadaf and I welcome you all to Women Influencers Talk Show. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, please do so right now. Dr. Smriti Naswa Singh is a gold medalist in MD from Government Medical College, Vadodara, Gujarat. She has done her senior residency from Sanjay Gandhi Memorial Hospital, Government of Delhi. She is currently a consultant dermatologist in Fortis Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Smriti has been assistant editor of Indian Journal of Sexually Transmitted Diseases and AIDS and is now in its editorial advisory board. She has more than 17 publications in various books and PubMed Index journals to her credit. Besides this, she is a Visharad in Bharatanatyam, an Ashtanga yoga enthusiast, and has a special interest in lifestyle management. Hello, Dr. Smriti. It's such an honor for us to have you today on Women Influencers Talk Show. How are you doing?
Hello Sadaf, thank you for inviting me to Women Influencers Talk Show. I'm doing very well. How about you?
All well, Doctor. Thank you so much. Now, I was wondering where to start your interview from. You have been such a meritorious student all your life. You ranked first in your boards, then state ranked 12th in your class 12th, then 6th in your university during MBBS, and then a gold medalist in MD. You have been a winner all along. So what has been the key to success for you?
Well, if you ask me, I have always followed one mantra, which is beautifully summarized by Gita's verse, Karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana, that you should only focus on the work, increasing your knowledge, learning. You should not focus too much about the result. When you work in a result-oriented basis, the essence of working just goes somewhere. The journey is as beautiful as the destination. Sirf manzilon ki wait karte rahenge, to raston ko kaun enjoy karega? From the beginning, I have always focused on learning new things, to grasp new things, increasing my knowledge. This became even more important when I entered medical field, because the medical field gave me a sense of responsibility. So just the focus on the journey, learning, knowledge, and not thinking too much about the results has been something that have been my driving force.
That's great and very rightly said. Ultimately, it's the journey that matters and not just the destination. Dr. Smriti, you come from a family where science was an everyday dinner time conversation topic. So please tell us a little bit about your family and your childhood years.
So science was our staple diet, if I may say so, during our childhood years. Both my mother and father come from a science background. They both are chemistry people, and I have a brother who is an engineer and MBA. So throughout our childhood years, we used to talk science, and in every conversation topic, it would be maths and science. Like, if I give you an example, as simple as something like suji ka halwa, if I ask my mom, how do you make it? And she will tell me it's 1:1:4, one of the flour, one of the jaggery, and 4 of water is what you keep. And I have remembered it ever since. So today also, if I cut a tomato, I would be cutting it into half, and then 1/4, and then 1/8, like that. My parents, they used to motivate us to go inside the kitchen and the store area and read the ingredient list of every household, say your soaps and detergents and everything. And this has continued with me till date. As I have become a dermatologist, I would ensure that I would read the ingredients. Say I go to a cosmetic store or a grocery store or any place, I would read the detailed ingredient lists, and that helps me in my current practice as well. So one thing also that helped in my childhood years was that both my parents were central government employees. My father is from ONGC and my mother retired from Kendra Vidyalaya Sangathan. So we used to move a lot. Every 5 years, every 2 years in fact, many a times, we would be changing not only cities but also states. What that helps me is during my upbringing, I've met people from different walks of life, different backgrounds, religion, region, caste, and we truly had a cosmopolitan upbringing that really broadened our thought process and our horizons. And till date, if I have to move to different places, I would actually look forward to it. I would be excited. Okay, let's make new friends. Let's know more people while continuing the old friendships. Also, because of Kendra Vidyalaya Sangathan, around 10 to 12 years of my childhood, we lived in defense areas. So defense inculcated a sense of discipline in our lifestyle and put forth health and being fit. That was very, very important. You know, when we were growing up, there would be people walking of all ages. They would be either walking or running or playing some sport. But would be very, very, give very, very importance to the health and fitness. That still continues in my day-to-day thought process and how I am now upbringing my kids.
Sure. That's something we should all imbibe and apply in our lifestyle. Now, you went on to work as a senior resident in Sanjay Gandhi Memorial Hospital in Delhi and then worked as a senior consultant dermatologist in Calcutta, where you met two stalwarts in plastic and cosmetic surgery and hair transplant, Dr. Manoj Khanna and Dr. S.S. Chatterjee. So how has such work experience helped you go ahead professionally?
So, as I said that I always wanted to learn a lot, and learning has always been my focus. So I really believe that, universe conspired in a way that I get to get so many more opportunities to learn. So Government Medical College, Baroda, definitely was the reason why I have the foundation, the strong foundation, like your roots. Learning under Dr. Marfatia, he taught me how to, just diagnose the skin diseases. Sanjay Gandhi Hospital was my first stint as a doctor where I knew that my treatment is the one that the patient is going to take home. And daily 150, 200 patients helped me create that confidence in dermatology. After that, it was supposed to go to, the move had to go for the cosmetology, and as luck would have it, I got to work with one of the most famous cosmetic surgeons in India, Dr. Manoj Khanna. And the icing on top was Dr. Chatterjee, who is one of the senior most plastic surgeons of India. So they taught me the basics of private clinical practice. When I was in Calcutta, the patients shifted to clients. I was working as an aesthetician, a cosmetic dermatologist, and pastry people, radio jockeys, cricketers, even the actors from Bangladesh, Bengal, television, and all those filmmakers would be coming to our clinics. There were people who were coming who would actually be, roaming around the world, meeting dermatologists from all over the world. It was a learning experience. So this kind of experience was one of the reasons why entering in as a consultant into Fortis, the confidence was there, and ever since I've been here and have been doing well. I'm still in contact with all my erstwhile seniors and doctors, and I keep talking to them. Also, what helped is that because we as doctors, we have to learn the local language. So Gujarat helped me learn Gujarati. In North, I was around Bihari and UP laborers. So they taught me that dialect. In West Bengal, when I was supposed to go to Calcutta, I learned Bengali 1 or 2 months before and with a crash course with a book and all. And that just helped me. Because today also when I am in Mumbai, which is, I would not even say it's a cosmopolitan city of India, it's global city of India. So we get a lot of not even Indian but international patients. And say Bangladeshi patients come to me and I tell them, I understand your Bengali, please speak in your language. That suddenly gives that comfort zone to them that they can talk in their own language. They'll be able to explain things better. So knowing 4 or 5 languages, and knowing the regions, because there are certain diseases which would be more common in particular region. So that also really helped me. As circumstances would have it, my movement to 3 different metropolitan cities of India helped me grow professionally, definitely.
Wow, what better than to have a multilingual doctor, and I'm sure it's such a comfort level for your patients too. Now, post your Calcutta stint, you are now associated with Fortis Hospital, Mulund, Mumbai as a consultant dermatologist and have been working there for more than 6 years now. Your move from Delhi to Calcutta and then to Mumbai, I'm sure you must have had your share of professional and personal challenges, because many women hesitate to take big steps professionally. How did you overcome obstacles, if any?
I'm a firm believer of this thought ki jo hota hai, achhe ke liye hota hai. And I always look into the positives when life gives me any challenge or any experiences. I always think positive and usme se sari achhaiyon pe focus karne ki mujhe aadat hai. So I got married to Karan, and he also is from ONGC background. He was also moving every 5 years. So those things from the personal aspect were very similar in our case. My firm belief is that the personal and professional lives go hand in hand. When you are happy personally, you will grow professionally. So personally, it was never a problem. Throughout my childhood years, we were moving and there would be teething troubles. It's not like you do not have teething issues, but we were always mentally prepared that whenever we are going to a new city for a couple of months, there would be some hindrances when we are trying to focus on even, you know, getting maids, getting our cook or driving and all those things. Settling to a new place comes with the teething troubles, but that itself is fun. Now, usme bhi to maza hai. So moving was not difficult, and I would suggest everyone to not worry too much about it and have as many experiences in life as possible.
I'm sure a lot of people will relate to what you have just said, because travel anyways makes a person wiser. Dr. Smriti, you have specialized in managing and treating very difficult cases of skin diseases, allergies, and even drug reactions where patients have suffered from chronic diseases like diabetes, heart diseases, kidney diseases, and many more. So what motivates you to get into the root cause of it?
In Fortis, in the last 6.5 years, I have been treating and managing skin conditions where patients invariably have a lot of other comorbidities like diabetes, patients are on dialysis, transplant, chemotherapy, pregnant ladies, kids, patients in ICU. All these make the diseases and their treatment more challenging. Also, being in Mumbai, I was lucky enough to meet many people who treated their diseases by overhauling their food habits, and they worked on their mental strength and they worked on their exercising schedules, yoga, meditation. So this changed my thought process of treating the disease and not only looking on the skin. When a patient comes to you, he wants to go back happy, healthy, and free from the disease. So I thought that if patient is there, say for example, coming with many recurrent skin infections and he has diabetes, which I know is the root cause of the recurring skin infections, then I started also focusing on the lifestyle changes to treat the root cause of the skin infection, so that eventually they stop getting them. The recurrences either decrease or they never come back.
Right. So what I understand is that you treat your patients holistically. Dr. Smriti, cosmetology is a field of science which is so popular in the beauty world these days. In fact, people go to the extent of having surgical treatments to beautify them. Is it safe? What do you have to say on this?
As you said, cosmetology is a field of science. And it is an ever-progressing field of science. So whatever new therapies, treatments, procedures, whether surgical or not surgical, are coming, they are backed by scientific data and clinical trials. So, and I believe you have one life. If you want to look great, then you should. When the procedures, whether surgical procedures like facelifts and all, or non-surgical procedures like laser treatments, derma rollers or chemical peels are done by a dermatologist and an experienced person who knows his field well, then it is definitely safe. The doctor will know the possible side effects and the complications and what are the precautions that have to be taken. He or she will explain the patient very well what would be the pre-procedure care and post-procedure precautions that the patient has to take. And nowadays, patients are also very well informed. They do their research. And I'm very happy that they come and they discuss all the questions that they have in their mind with their doctors. So when done by a dermatologist, the procedures are safe and they are backed by scientific data.
Okay, so specifically if we talk about the non-surgical treatments, what are the ways of treating problems like acne and sagging skin, which are so common these days? And please suggest us some ways so that women who isn't accessible to modern techniques can also benefit from it.
You have asked about two conditions, acne and sagging skin. At the outset, I would like to say that those who do not have access to modern techniques and lasers and big machines need not worry, because after all, these are dermatological problems and they can be managed well with creams and lotions and small OPD based procedures. So if I talk about acne, they usually affect teenagers and adolescents because of the hormonal changes of puberty. And creams, some simple vitamin medicines and chemical peels, which are OPD based procedures, work very well in treating and managing the acne. People do get pigmentation spots left after the acne, and there also creams and chemical peels do work. Sometimes you also have very deep acne, especially the boys, the men, they get acne scars. For that, procedures like derma roller do work wonders in few sittings, and they don't need or require big equipments. When it comes to sagging skin, that is a part of aging process, and there are multiple modalities like thread lifts and many radio frequency thermage procedures and some laser lifts. They are all non-surgical, OPD based. They can be done with just an application of anesthetic cream, and they don't need any big OT setup or even admission. Patient comes and get the procedure done in half an hour, 1 hour, and then goes home. And next day, nobody would know if anything has been done or not. So these things are also managed very well in those people who have problems with regards to the accessibility of modern techniques. Simple things like some anti-aging creams, vitamin A based or hyaluronic acid based, they are easily available in the pharmacies and even online nowadays. Having a good regime of applying sunscreen in the daytime and a night skin cream works for them. With that, as my focus has always been on lifestyle, I would also like to tell my teenagers that if you are getting acne, try to shift to a cleaner diet with 2 to 3 fruits every day and multiple different colors of vegetables every day, like 4 or 5 different colors. Because the more the color that you give, the more vitamin A you have, and vitamin A helps clear your acne. Similarly, for the sagging skin, the best thing proven worldwide to be the best anti-aging concoction is exercise. So lose your weight, reach to BMI less than 23, and exercise, and that's the best thing to keep the sagging skin away.
Those are some great tips. Thank you so much. And I'm sure our viewers will be benefiting from all that you have just mentioned. But I'm not going to let you go before I ask you, what is the secret to a glowing skin? Please share some tips.
So there are a few very simple tips and tricks to have a glowing and healthy skin day in and day out. First thing is that you should know what type of skin you have, whether it is normal, oily, dry, or sensitive. And search for a face wash and a body cleanser, a body wash or a soap accordingly. Say for example, if you have an oily skin, then you will have more active oil glands and then you'll be acne prone. You'll also be dandruff prone. So in that case, usually you should find out some face washes which are salicylic acid based, or they are written as oily skin cleanser, and glycolic acid based face washes also work very well. If you have dry skin, then you should find out something which has inherent moisturizing capacity in them, something which makes you dry. Say for example, a neem based soap. That would work really well for an oily acne prone skin, but that would make a dry skin very dry. So their aloe vera based moisturizing soaps and body washes and face washes work wonders. Normal skin are the blessed skin. They can just go with any lotions or creams. Sensitive skin have to take care extra. They have to go for some face washes and moisturizers and soaps which are color free, which are fragrance free, which also do not come with lot many ingredients, because they can become allergic to any of the ingredients. That is step number one. Step number two is to remember that moisturizing is your best friend. Moisturized skin is glowing skin, dry skin is dull skin. So whatever your age be, whatever of your type of skin be, just have a habit to apply moisturizer on your face and your body, preferably on wet skin, at least once a day, and if possible, twice a day. For the acne prone skin, you should search for a moisturizer which is non-comedogenic. For the dry skin, you should prefer creams over lotions. For the normal skin, go for creams in winters and lotions in summers and monsoons. The third thing is that if you are going out in sun a lot and you have a work where you have to be in field, then you should go for physical sun protection, like putting your hat or cap or taking an umbrella, wearing goggles. That would prevent the sun rays directly coming onto your skin, especially the facial skin, and prevent the aging which happens because of sun exposure. Having said that, I want to mention here that vitamin D is closely interlinked with all your health things and all your disease processes. So it's very important to have your daily sunlight in the early morning or in the late evening, where it is not heat it's the light which is there, which does not feel like heat on your skin, and be there for 20-30 minutes and let your vitamin D levels grow. The last tip is that according to the age and the skin type and the requirement, you can ask your dermatologist for a night cream. Say an acne patient will have a cream which is either retinoid based or benzoyl peroxide based, as suiting by the dermatologist, and he can keep the acne under control. An aging skin will have a vitamin A based or C based or a hyaluronic acid based serum, and that will work to keep the aging process delayed as much as possible. One more thing is to have a very good diet. Very good diet means you should have lots of fruits, lots of raws, lots of salads, and you should sleep on time, preferably by 10 p.m. so that your thyroid is happy, your skin is happy, and exercise at least 3 hours a week. Inculcate in a hobby that makes you happy so that you are mentally relaxed.
Now, this answer is going to be a takeaway of this episode. Dr. Smriti, you are not just a specialist doctor, but you are a writer, poet, and also a dancer. Please tell us about this multi-talented side of yours.
So for this, I give credit to my parents. They saw the dancer in me. And I still remember when I was young, my father will come back from office at 6 p.m. and he was tired. Still, he would just change his dress, have a cup of tea and take me in his scooter to my dance class. And the poem writing I learned from my Hindi teacher, Malviya Madam. Till today, I love writing. I love speaking on stage, and dancing is the thing that I'm most passionate about. It keeps me happy. Hobbies keep you happy and mentally relaxed in the current state when you are professionally, you can have a mental burnout and all those things. These things that keep you sane.
That's right. In fact, I have read somewhere that a hobby a day keeps the doldrums away. Dr. Smriti, thank you so much for coming on our show and gracing us with your presence. But before I say goodbye to you, what are your thoughts about our talk show?
Well, Sadaf, I must tell you, this is indeed an incredible platform where you are giving opportunities to all the women who have been trying to do something in life and who are passionate about what they are doing, whether professionally or personally. And you're giving them a platform to connect with each other and, you know, motivate each other and grow with one another. I really wish all of you, your team, all the best, and may you grow exponentially. Thank you for inviting me to this show. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Smriti, for your kind words and your good wishes. We wish you all the very best in your life. Keep rising and keep shining. And all you beautiful people, if you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, please do so now. Please like, share, and also comment below. So till we meet next time again, take care, stay safe, and be happy.